I welcome you this day to St. John's United Church in Campbellford as we worship together online. May God be with each and every one of you. Almighty God, we thank you for planting in us the seed of your word. By your Holy Spirit, help us to receive it with joy, live according to it, and grow in faith and hope and love. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Psalm 18, verses 1 to 6. How I love you, Lord! You are my defender. The Lord is my protector. He is my strong fortress. My God is my protection, and with him I am safe. He protects me like a shield. He defends me and keeps me safe. I call to the Lord, and he saves me from my enemies. Praise the Lord! The danger of death was all around me. The waves of destruction rolled over me. The danger of death was around me, and the grave set its trap for me. In my trouble I called to the Lord. I called to my God for help. In his temple he heard my voice. He listened to my cry for help. Genesis 3, verses 6 to 11. The woman saw how beautiful the tree was, and how good its fruit would be to eat. And she thought how wonderful it would be to become wise. So she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave some to her husband, and he also ate it. As soon as they had eaten it, they were given understanding and realized that they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and covered themselves. That evening, they heard the Lord God walking in the garden, and they hid from him among the trees. But the Lord God called out to the man, "Where are you?" He answered, "I heard you in the garden. I was afraid and hid from you because I was naked." "Who told you that you were naked?" God asked. "Did you eat the fruit that I told you not to eat?" The man answered, "The woman you put here with me gave me the fruit, and I ate it." The Lord God asked the woman, "Why did you do this?" She replied, "The snake tricked me into eating it." Romans chapter 1 and verses 1 to 7. From Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus and an apostle chosen and called by God to preach his good news. The good news was promised long ago by God through his prophets as written in the Holy Scriptures. It is about his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. As to his humanity, he was born a descendant of David. As to his divine holiness, he was shown with great power to be the Son of God by being raised from death. Through him, God gave me the privilege of being an apostle for the sake of Christ, in order to lead people of all nations to believe and obey. This also includes you who are in Rome, whom God has called to belong to Jesus Christ. And so I write to all of you in Rome, whom God loves and has called to be his own people. May God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ give you grace and peace. The Holy Gospel of Matthew, chapter 4, and verses 18 to 25. As Jesus walked along the shore of Lake Galilee, he saw two brothers who were fishermen, Simon, called Peter, and his brother Andrew, catching fish in the lake with a net. Jesus said to them, "Come with me, and I will teach you to catch people." At once they left their nets and went with him. He went on and saw two other brothers, James and John, the sons of Zebedee. They were in their boat with their father Zebedee, getting their nets ready. Jesus called them, and at once they left the boat and their father and went with him. Jesus went all over Galilee, teaching in the synagogues, preaching the good news about the kingdom, and healing people who had all kinds of disease and sickness. The news about him spread through the whole country of Syria, so that people brought to him all those who were sick, suffering from all kinds of diseases and disorders, people with demons and epileptics and paralytics, and Jesus healed them all. Large crowds followed him from Galilee and the 10 towns, from Jerusalem, Judea, and the land on the other side of the Jordan. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Quite a few years ago, I heard this saying, and I'm not sure who spoke it. Maybe I'll be able to find out later. But it went something like this. Jesus called his church to be fishers of men, not keepers of the aquarium. I really think I heard this when I was just starting out in ministry. I really liked the saying because it seemed, even as I was beginning as a student minister, it seemed like a lot of times we were just keepers of the aquarium. We weren't out seeking the lost, seeking those who had never heard maybe about Jesus Christ, or certainly maybe had forgotten about him. See, I understand what it's like to keep an aquarium. Not so much how to fish. I'm not much of a fisherman. Although I did say at one time, I used to tell people I had never caught a fish smaller than this. Or I could even say smaller than this. Because I had never caught a fish. Every time I went out fishing, I never caught anything. So I never caught a fish smaller than this. I just didn't catch any fish. So I don't know what it's like to fish too well. But I know what it's like to keep an aquarium. In fact, I kept a few of them at one point. And keeping an aquarium is just, you're keeping the fish alive, looking after them, feeding them, and it's also transferring them. This is how I always kind of thought of that imagery of us as the church being the keepers of the aquarium, because so often we will have someone coming from another denomination or church in the same town suddenly coming to our church and we think we're growing. Well, the church isn't growing. The church is just moving things around a bit, moving from one church to the other. When we grow, we are actually having new people come to the church, new people that maybe have never been at church or haven't been in years and years. We're not just shifting things around a little bit from one denomination to the other. Well, this,
This year we have a new minister at St. John's. He's maybe better than the other ones, or maybe he's not. Maybe we'll go elsewhere. And really, our call as Christians is to be disciples. I kind of like the word students in replace of disciples. Disciples has that element of discipline and something we should have, but maybe in our day and age, student would be the better terminology. That we are to be students of Jesus Christ. This is what we're looking at as we consider the stained glass windows, and this week it is the call of the disciples. As Jesus goes and he finds them fishing, and that's why I started with that phrase too, because that's what he calls them to. He says, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. He used where he found them. They were fishermen, Peter and John out in the boat. He found them doing what they knew, and he used a phrase that they would understand. They were fishermen, but of course they were catching fish. And he said, follow me and you'll catch men. Because Jesus had come to make disciples, to make students. And these 12 eventually became his students, his disciples. They followed him around. They learned from him and about him. And their call was also the call for others to follow as well. In fact, even the first few disciples, they go and sometimes find their brother or find a relative or find someone else they knew. Nathanael, who they found and said, we found the Messiah. Our call as the church is to make disciples. Our call as the church is to spread the good news of Jesus Christ. And it is good news, in spite of sometimes the way it's presented. It is good news. It's good news that Christ, our Lord, our Creator, in the person of Jesus Christ, has loved us and come to call us. The other passage we read this morning is from Romans, and Paul in that talks about calling, the calling. This is what we're talking about, the calling of the disciples. We are the disciples, we are the students, and we're called as well. He talks about his calling. Three times in just those 7 or 8 verses, he uses the word called or calling. He was called by God through Jesus Christ, and now he is calling others, and he talks of those who have been called and loved. You were called and loved by Christ. I am called and loved by Jesus Christ. You are called and loved by Jesus Christ. Once you give yourself to him, you become his student. It's hard to be a student nowadays. It's hard to listen. It's hard to follow what our Lord would ask of us. It's never been easy to do that. I think it's just as hard now as it ever was, even though you would think in some ways it would be easier. In North America in particular, in Western society, we have so much freedom. So much freedom we have. Even though we've been going through this COVID and we're starting to get more freedoms, even then we still have so much freedom to do what we want. Yes, there were limitations. Yes, there still are some limitations. But overall, we still have so much freedom. Not everywhere in the world has that freedom. You're not necessarily free everywhere in the world to follow Jesus Christ. The call of discipleship in Canada, well, I wouldn't say it's easy. It's still never easy to be a student. In fact, I think it's harder in some respects. But it's not hard in the sense of having to suffer physically through torture, people killed because they believe in Jesus Christ. That still goes on in our day and age. I may post the numbers on here as I'm speaking of how many we estimate annually die for the faith in Jesus Christ. Because some places it's just not allowed. Some places it's so frowned upon you will be hurt. Not here. We have that great freedom of religion. But we use our freedom, unfortunately, not to go to church. We use our freedom not to take part. I call you friends. Friends, we can't be this way. Friends, we have to listen to our calling, follow our calling, be students of our Lord. Being a Christian isn't just about, well, I'm never sure quite how to describe it in our day and age. Sometimes it seems for some. For me, at times, it can be just about, I say I believe, and that's all there is to it. But it's more than that. It's more than just believing something. It's willing to stop what we're doing and doing something else. So if we come back to the call of the disciples, consider this, their regular work. Doesn't mean every one of us will have to give up our regular work, but I have little doubt that all of us have to give up something. Because there's things we shouldn't be doing. Things and ways we are living that we shouldn't be living. And if we would follow Christ, if we would lay down those things that aren't helpful for us or for others, we would follow. The disciples left their regular work, fishermen. They set it aside because this fellow showed up, this fellow who was different, this fellow who spoke to them and called them personally and said to them, come with me, follow me, and I'll make something different of you. And they followed. And that is the call for every one of us. Will we hear Jesus' call? You are loved and you are called. Oh, it's scary at times, because it may mean changing things we do, the way we behave, the way we think. But it's also full of joy and surprise. The way we can learn to love, even in the midst of suffering. The way we can learn to appreciate others, even when they're not always kind to us. The way to have forgiveness for those who have harmed us. And then, because in reality, forgiveness is good for us, we find peace. For each one of you listening to this, for each one of you who have chosen this path, you are called. You are loved. Follow Christ. He is the only one to follow and the only one worth following.
In this time of desperation,
greater than the songs we sing
in our weakness and temptation.
God, increase the faith and energy of your church to desire and work for the salvation of all people, that they might be freed from sin and that hope be renewed in many hearts, to the increase of the kingdom of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.